Hello students, now we are going to discuss about the parameters involved in the study of the elementary particles. So what are the parameters? Parameters are certain quantities which are measured for the elementary quantities. So they are, these parameters gives the knowledge of their characteristic variables. So these are the characteristics, these are the parameters, these are the variables that are defined for each elementary particle. So the first parameter that we are going to discuss for the elementary particle is about the rest mass. So each particle is associated with its rest mass. So what do you mean by rest mass? We have, according to the relativistic Einstein relation, that E is equal to under root of m naught square C4 plus P square C square, where the energy is not only related to the rest mass energy, or it is not only related to the momentum. So it is a sum of both the rest mass energy as well as the momentum. So the energy is given by this formula, where this is giving the energy, rest mass energy, and this is giving the energy due to the particle in motion. So E, m naught, p are the energy, rest mass and linear momentum of the elementary particles. Now we know that certain particles are always at rest. If the particle is at rest always, then the momentum, linear momentum is equal to m into v, then the linear momentum will be equal to zero. Then the energy contribution will be only due to the rest mass, and therefore E will be equal to m naught c square, because under root of m naught square c4 will be m naught c square. So the contribution of energy will be only due to the rest mass, whereas the photons, neutrinos, gravitons, they all are having their rest mass equal to zero. Their m naught is equal to zero because they possess energy due to its motion. Like neutrino, gravitons, photons have their m naught equal to zero because they are never at rest and their rest mass is zero. Therefore, the first contribution of the energy will be equal to zero, and E is equal to under root of p square c square, which is equal to pc. So E will be given, that is the energy will be due to the particle in motion, and it will be equal to p into c. So the rest mass is an important parameter for the elementary particle, and we generally express the rest mass in terms of the rest mass of the electron. So every particle, when we calculate or tabulate the elementary particles, we always express the rest masses in the multiple of the rest mass of the electron. So it is expressed as the multiple of Me, or many a times it also expressed in the units of electron volt or mega electron volt. So this is the parameter rest mass. Next we talk about the electrical charge. So electrical charge is also an important parameter. It also gives a characteristic variable to the elementary particle, because the elementary particle could be either a positively charged, negatively charged or neutral particle. So the electrical charges are also important parameter, and the electrical charges are similarly expressed as the multiple of the electronic charge carried by the electron. So electrical charge is quantized, and they are also expressed as zero or integral multiples, positive or negative, of the fundamental electronic charge E. And we always know, we know that the electronic charge was calculated by the J.J. Thomson, or the J.J. Thomson calculated the electronic charge in the E by M measurement, and the Millikan had also calculated the electronic charge by the using the oil drop method. So the elementary charges, elementary particles are expressed in terms of the multiples of the electronic charge, and they are assigned a positive, negative or the neutral values. So they carry the electrical charges also. The third parameter of the elementary particle is the certain quantum numbers. So here we have majorly three quantum numbers: the nucleon number, the lepton number and the baryon number. So the nucleon number, what do you mean by nucleon number? Nucleon number is also a quantum number. It is the number of nucleons in a particular reaction. So if a reaction takes place, the number of nucleons must be also conserved. If in the product side there are a certain number of nucleons, so on the reactant side also there must be equivalent number of nucleons, so that the energy or the process is conserved. So n determines the number of nucleon, and this n is itself a quantum number. So this must remain conserved in any decay process. For example, we take the conversion of neutron into proton, electron and antineutrino. So on the reactant side we see that there is one neutron, that is one nucleon. So on the product side also the number of nucleons should be one, because nucleon consists of protons and neutrons. So if there is one nucleon on the left hand side, so number of nucleons on the right hand side here is also proton is one, so there is one nucleon. So n is conserved on the in this process. And the mean lifetime, if we see, for the stable free proton is 10 raised to power 21 years. It is not that the number of nucleons is again subsequently decaying, that the decay process is not a stable process. So the nucleon number should be conserved. The next quantum number is the lepton number. In the classification of the elementary particles, we have already listed that which particle is under the lepton family. So there were majorly 8 particles under the lepton family. There was electron, positrons, mu minus meson, mu positive meson. Then there was neutrinos, electron neutrino, electron antineutrino, mu neutrino and mu antineutrinos. So for these 8 particles, they are under the lepton family, and we assign the lepton number to these 8 particles. So in these 8 particles, we had 4 were the particles and 4 are their antiparticles. So the lepton number is assigned positive 1 for the particle, that is for nu e, nu nu electron and mu minus meson, the lepton number is plus 1. Whereas for its antiparticle, we have for the electron mu antineutrino, for the mu antineutrino, positron and mu positive meson, we have lepton number equal to minus 1. And for all the rest of the elementary particles which are not under the lepton family, the lepton number is 0. Lepton number, which was defined by L, is a quantum number for the electron. Here the nucleon number was for the protons and neutrons. So lepton number is for the electrons, which is also a stable particle. And this quantum number, this lepton number, belongs to the family to which the electron belongs. So there were 8 particles in the lepton family, and the lepton numbers are assigned to these 8 elementary particles. So majorly 4 particles are having a positive sign and the antiparticles are having the negative sign. Rest all the elementary particles are having the lepton number as 0. So the next quantum number is the baryon number. So the baryon number, so this baryon number is assigned to which particles? They are assigned to the nucleons and hyperons again. So nucleon has 2 quantum number. One is the nucleon number itself and the baryon number. So majorly when we have to conserve the processes, we have to satisfy the laws of conservation. So we majorly say about the baryon number and not about the nucleon number. So we are more interested in the baryon number for the nucleons. So the quantum number for the behavior of the nucleons and the hyperons, because the baryon number is for the baryon family and the baryon consists of the nucleons and the hyperons. So baryon number is assigned to the nucleons and the hyperons. So again, in the same fashion as the lepton number was assigned, baryon number is also a positive 1 for the particles. So the particles which are coming in the baryon numbers are proton, neutron, lambda 0, sigma positive, sigma 0, sigma minus, xi neutral, xi negative and omega minus. So these are the particles. So if a baryon number is plus 1, and for the antiparticle baryon number is minus 1. And for rest all the elementary particles which are not under the baryon family, the baryon number is assigned 0. So please remember, for the particle baryon number is plus 1. For antiparticles, the baryon number is minus 1, and for rest, everything, the baryon number is 0. So the next parameter is the parity. So in the parity, we already know that the reflection of the coordinates of the system takes place. That if we interchange the coordinates with a negative sign, so all the coordinates are taken in the negative coordinate system, and if we replace the coordinates with the negative coordinates, so what is the effect on the wave function? Whether the wave function remains the same or the wave function takes a negative sign. So that determines the parity of the system. So parity is the wave mechanical system is completely described by the wave function psi r, and we replace the coordinates r with a negative sign and see what is happening on the coordinate psi r, whether the psi r takes a positive sign or it is a negative sign. So we have assigned a positive or a negative with the quantity p, which is taken as the parity. So if the parity value comes out to be plus 1, then the system is said to possess the even parity, and if it takes a negative sign, the system is said to possess a odd parity. So parity is, again I am talking about, the parity is again the reflection operation of the coordinates. So parity is related to the symmetry of the wave function. So the parity should be conserved for the interactions or the decay processes. So we have the conservation law. So according to Leibniz, the conservation law was defined as that if a certain process is taking place in a certain way and the process is viewed by reflection in the mirror, that we take the process by reflection in the mirror, we see it in the mirror. So whether the process will look alike, it would be same or it would be some different. So it was seen that if the process is again viewed by the reflection in the mirror, it would also occur with the same or equal probability. So this was the conservation law. And it was also seen some other conservation has also be followed. So the other conservations that to be followed were the CPT theorem. So what was in the CPT theorem? So CPT theorem basically constitutes of the three operations. So there were three symmetry operations in the CPT theorem. So the CPT theorem consisted of, the first one was the parity that we have already discussed. Second symmetry operation was of the charge conjugation, and the third was the time invariance. So here we shall be talking about the differences in the three type of the symmetry operations. So what happened in the parity that we have already discussed, that the reflection of the coordinates takes place. So the reflection operation of the coordinates happens in the parity, whereas in the charge conjugation, what is taken, that every elementary particle is replaced by its antiparticle. That if it is a positive particle, it is replaced by a negative particle, and so on. So a particle is replaced by its antiparticle, and we see that what type of the interaction or what type of the process takes place, whether the symmetry is observed or not. And the third type was the time invariance. So the time invariance means that if we are moving a particular direction in the forward process and we then move that process in the backward direction, so the whether the symmetry is maintained or not maintained, that is the symmetry operation. So we can see that if a operation is taken in a forward direction or it is moved in a forward direction, so what happens if it is moved in the reverse direction, or if we rewind, so what is happening? So that means the process is conserved or not. So that comes under the time invariance. So it was observed that the parity process, parity conservation, is obeyed by all the strong and the electromagnetic interactions. So these strong and electromagnetic interactions obey the parity. Strong and electromagnetic interactions also obey the charge conjugation, and it also obeys the time invariance. So strong and electromagnetic obeys all the three types of the symmetry operations, whereas the weak interactions do not obey, do not conserve the weak interactions. So the parity is not conserved in the weak interaction, just as the decay process of the beta decays where the neutrinos are involved. So the weak interactions are not conserved in the not conserved by parity. They are also not conserved by the charge conjugation. Symmetry is not observed in the weak interaction by the beta decay process also. But we have seen that the time invariance symmetry operation obeys or it conserves the weak interactions. It is observed in weak interaction for some very small violation. There is some very frequent cases such as the decay of K neutral meson, where this weak interaction is not obeying the time invariance also. But generally all weak interactions are obeying the conservation of the time invariance. So we say that the strong and electromagnetic interactions obey all the three types, that is the parity, charge conjugation and the time invariance. Parity and conjugation is charge conjugation is not obeyed by the weak interaction, but the weak interactions conservation are obeyed by the time invariance. However, it has been found that if we take the combined effect of the charge conjugation and the parity, then the weak interactions are also conserved. So the beta decay process is conserved when we take the combined effect of the charge conjugation and parity. But if we see it individually, parity, if we see individual operation of the charge conjugation, then the beta decay process would not be conserved. But the combined effect of charge and parity conjugation will lead to the conservation of the beta decay process. So now, what is CPT theorem? So these were the different individual charge conjugation, parity and the time invariance. So what had been found in the CPT theorem, that if we study any of the decay process, any interaction, whether it is strong, electromagnetic or weak interaction, and we apply all the three symmetry operation, that is the charge conjugation, time invariance and the parity, then it has been observed that it might be any of the interaction would be conserved. So it is irrelevant whether we talk about individual charge, individual parity or individual time invariance. If all the three are applied, and the application could be of any manner, whether we apply first parity, whether we apply first time invariance or we apply the charge conjugation. So the operation could be in any manner, in any order, but if all the three applications are applied, all the three operations, the symmetry operations are applied for a particular interaction, then that interaction would be conserved. So the CPT theorem states that for all the types of interaction, whether it is a strong, electromagnetic or weak, they are conserved, or the process remains invariant under the combined operation of the charge, parity and the time invariance, and these operations could be taken in any order. So the beta decay process, which was not conserved individually under the charge conjugation symmetry operation, it was not conserved individually amongst the parity operation, but it was conserved by the combined effect of the CP, and it would also remain conserved under the combined effect of the three type of the operations, that is the charge conjugation, parity and time invariance. So applying all the three symmetry operations would conserve any type of the interaction. So I hope that you have understood the parity parameter also.